Today on the Run to the Top podcast.
Well, you got to be more than a runner, you know, because that could be a very temporary thing. And so we always had this conversation going on about, like, you know, if I step off a curb in the wrong way tomorrow and my running career is over, am I a well enough rounded person that I'm still going to find joy in my life?
Welcome to the Run to the Top podcast from Runners Connect, where it's all about learning from the best and most inspiring minds in the sport. Together, we can train a smarter, healthier, and faster running community. Now here's your host, Sinead Hockey.
Hi everyone, and welcome to Run to the Top. This is Sinead here with you for this latest episode brought to you by Runners Connect. Thank you so much for joining me today. If you're listening to this on your run, I hope you're having a great one and that this podcast helps power you through those later miles. If you missed last week's episode, I have a feeling you'll want to check it out. My good friend and Skechers performance athlete Esther Atkins joined us to talk about everything from the pitfalls of comparison, her tips for improving mental toughness, and the importance of determining and playing to your own strengths. Esther was the 2014 USA Marathon Champion, and she's got quite a few more credits to her name. But what I love about Esther is that she just really enjoys offering her experience to help runners of all walks of life. She really covered quite a lot during that interview and things that could really benefit any runner, myself included. So be sure to check that one out if you missed it. This week, we are joined by two pretty well-known guests. A little hint, they both ran under renowned coach Mark Wetmore at the University of Colorado during the late 90s. And one of them went on to compete at the 2000 Olympics and was featured in the classic novel Running with the Buffaloes. If you guessed Adam Goucher, then you are correct. He and his teammate Tim Catalano went on to found their company, Run the Edge, and between their combined experience running competitively and Tim's expertise in sports psychology, the two make for a pretty powerful duo with a lot of really incredible insight on the mental side of our sport. I am so excited to have Adam and Tim on the show with us today, so let's get right into it. Oh, and one more thing. Adam and Tim were kind enough to offer our listeners a discount on their Marathon Virtual Challenge, which they're just relaunching this month. Make sure to stay tuned till the end of the show to learn more about Marathon and how to get your discount. Now, without further ado, we'll take a quick break before jumping into our interview. I want to give a big thanks to Body Health for sponsoring Run to the Top and for giving us Perfect Amino. These eight essential amino acids are the building blocks of protein that my body needs to train harder and recover faster. You can enter to win a pack of six Perfect Amino bottles for free by visiting runnersconnect.net/bodyhealth. Thank you so much to Pacific Health Labs for sponsoring Run to the Top and for giving our listeners free samples of their all-natural Excel gels. Learn more on how to get your free samples at the end of this episode and check out Pacific Health Labs at runnersconnect.net/Pacific Health. Hi, Tim and Adam. Thanks so much for joining me today.
Thank you
for having us.
How are you guys doing today?
We're doing good.
Very good.
Thank you. How are you?
I'm good. I'm so excited to have you guys on, and I'm sure our listeners are as well. So first off, guys, obviously you're both very accomplished runners. I feel like most of our listeners probably know that by now. And you're very passionate about the sport. You've done a lot of work in the sport beyond your own running. So can you tell us a little bit about your background and how you first started getting into running and what really sparked your passion for the sport?
Well, that was really complimentary. I guess Adam is a lot more accomplished in running than I am, but I just tell you, I started running in high school and fell in love with it. Got really lucky and got a scholarship to run in college, which is where I had the misfortune of meeting Adam. But the sport's always been really good to me, and I love the way it makes me feel. And so I ran all the way through college and then didn't get to go professional, but that's okay. It's still been a part of my life ever since. And yeah, it's easy to be passionate about something that's so good for you, I think.
Oh, definitely. Definitely.
Yeah. I started running, I guess, seriously in high school, my sophomore year. I did do some track in junior high. But
you threw the discus, right?
No, that's about the thing I didn't do.
Oh, all right.
I take that back. I did throw it once.
Yeah.
Maybe twice.
I thought you told me you got like third, place, or was that the high jump?
Well, high jump. High jump. Yeah.
You didn't find your calling in the discus, clearly. I think, found it elsewhere.
in high school, and I was went on from high school. I was pretty successful. Went on to the University of Colorado. Had a good career there, despite having met Tim Catalano. still managed to be pretty fairly successful.
Usually when he ranks his like accomplishments in college in order, it goes meeting me and then the four national titles. Mm-hmm. I think
that's that sounds like a natural ranking there.
there's nothing more incorrect about that statement.
Whatever.
Yeah. Anyway, so decent career in college, ran professionally for 13 years, officially retired from the sport end of 2011, with a pretty bad knee injury, that I still hobble around with today with. So that's kind of the background the sport, running was for me, it was just something that, came natural and it just made me happy to be out running. Bottom line, it was good. It was good for everything.
It's weird how it can make you happy and miserable all at the same time.
It is.
It's really messed up sports.
Yeah.
I think runners, at the end of the day, they do enjoy it for the most part, but I think we all have a degree of masochism in us. So it's an interesting sport.
We do
sport.
Like stuff.
Yes, we do. We do.
So
Adam and I became friends, actually. Never thought of that until now, but
each other suffer.
It's a lot like running. It's been a suffer fest.
Yeah. You guys saw each other at each other's worst, and you
23
obviously,
years of suffer. Yeah. And still fun. Weird.
It's funny you used the term suffer fest, because I actually had this woman on a few weeks ago on the show who has, she's created a brewery called Suffer Fest, and it's all about beer for runners. So you guys should check that out if you're interested.
That's interesting.
Wow.
Sufferfest
beer.
Yeah.
Sufferfest beer company. Yep.
That's hilarious.
Yeah. So you guys, obviously you became best of friends despite what you might be telling me now. And
yeah, options. Yeah.
So you founded your company Run the Edge, which you're working together now, and you founded it with the debut of your book Running the Edge. So your company, it revolves around this book now. And what inspired you to write this book? What are some of the key principles in this book, and what really spurred you to write it?
You know, as I said, my career is coming to an end. I officially retired end of 2011, but I knew my career was kind of getting down to the point of how much longer am I going to do this? What am I going to do next? And Tim at the time was overseas teaching and kind of was on his way back to the US after 6+ years over there, and just kind of talking with him and saying, what are you going to do? What am I going to do? Just through that process. And quite honestly, it just came down to talking about some of the principles that he had been working on via his schooling and some of his aspirations post teaching, essentially, and just kind of how some of those principles, as he was relating to education, and telling me this, I was like, well, they're the exact same as they would relate to with running. Mm-hmm. And, and those principles, just kind of like, we just kind of wanted to do something different, write a book about, that was hopefully motivational, hopefully fun, and inspiring. So it was something a little bit crazy, didn't know where it would go, but we just took each challenge as it came and learned as we went, and just kind of built on itself since then.
Yeah. And we didn't want to write a normal running book.
Yeah.
Because, and anybody that's looked at it, it's not a normal running book.
Yeah.
you know, because there's so many books about what to eat and how to train and do all this stuff. We just don't want to be another one of those. So we just had to do something
different,
completely unique. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of how we came up with that. But it's actually been a really good thing, because then it's translated into, as you said, the principles from the book, you know, became our company, you know, because the book seems like forever ago now.
Oh, yeah. Forever.
You know, we don't focus too much on the book anymore. You know, our company's grown into all these virtual fitness challenges. But the principles from the book make their way into our fitness challenges, and they make their way into the way we run our company. And so I guess the book was a really good foundation for mm-hmm. that. And it's always something that we go back to going, all right, are we doing this the right way? And as long as we follow those principles, I think that's how we've been successful as a company.
Absolutely. Well, I do want to talk about the company in a few minutes here. But as for the book, obviously, you both have years of running experience, but Tim, you have a background in psychology, don't you? So what are some of the principles from the book, the philosophical concepts? I know you guys touched on Buddhism all the way down to Alcoholics Anonymous and even World of Warcraft at one point, didn't you? So what can you touch on a few of these and how they relate to your company today?
Yeah, for sure. Well, I mean, psychology, human behavior has always been really interesting to me. And obviously, that's what I studied in college as an undergrad. And then I ended up teaching that for 13 years. And the particular field in psychology that I was most interested in was positive psychology, because it allows for kind of free will and the idea that we can become more through experience. And
not so much the nihilism side of.
not so much just like, a lot of the predictive stuff of it. But I love that idea that we can become more and that we can become our best selves. So I got really into, you know, people like Carl Rogers and Viktor Frankl and Abraham Maslow. A lot of people have heard of him. But those guys that are like, hey, here's how you become your best self. Mm-hmm. And I always liked to teach that in high school. And then with running allows us to become our best self. And it's not that different from a lot of, you know, obviously it's weird to talk about Alcoholics Anonymous and World of Warcraft and things like that. But the principles of success are pretty much the same across the board. And what makes you successful in running makes you successful in life. And when Adam and I got together, we're just like, man, we could really mash up this idea of positive psychology with distance running. Mm-hmm. And that's how we would come up with something really, really unique, by applying those principles and looking at running and life and positive psychology and how to become our best selves.
Absolutely. And I think the discipline you get from running ends up extending to other areas of your life and even vice versa, like you said. So I can definitely see where these concepts from places that might not be so orthodox, especially compared to other running books, like for instance, Buddhism and Alcoholics Anonymous, where those might really help runners find success. So how did this extend into your company? And can you tell us a little bit about what you guys do and even how you came up with the name Run the Edge?
Yeah, I mean, Run the Edge is a metaphor for how close to our best selves. I'll just keep going. Adam's like, all right, you're just blabbing on. I tend to be a little bit of a talker.
He talks a little bit. That's all right.
But it's a metaphor for becoming our best self. Like, everybody has a different edge, which is our maximum potential in a certain thing. And running is just one of those things that everybody's got a maximum potential. Obviously, Adam's edge is a lot further along than mine. I was never going to be an Olympian like he was, but I could still get as close to my edge as possible. And the same thing with all of our other, you know, things we talk about in the book, all the different life stories, we can become better at each of those things and try to get closer to the edge.
Yeah. And I think that while writing the book, we started applying those things and kind of really thinking about it. I know for me personally, I mean, it was kind of a little bit of eye opening, because it's about really gaining the awareness, whether it's in your running, whether it's in other life stories as a husband for me or father or friend, or as in your business world, is to just say, am I applying myself to the point where I'm working as hard as I can and doing things the right way? Because if I am, then I will be successful. Mm. And so, you know, we kind of apply that in every aspect of Run the Edge. And it's just kind of who we are as people, but as I said, you know, for me going through this book, it was kind of like, oh, I can see where I'm doing pretty good. And at other times I could see, quite honestly, where I'm doing bad and needed to really work a little bit harder on things I had to work harder on.
Very interesting. I love how the book really extends to areas of your life beyond running. And I know a large part of the book had to do with what you guys called the six mirrors. So can you describe what this is to us?
Yeah, in just real brief terms, without going through each of the six mirrors, they're basically six attributes that each individual can have, from, you know, from determination and adaptability to personability, you know, just being, you know, we, like Adam said, it's a reflective process. You have to look in that mirror, look at you, and then we divide it up into where, well, here's my actual self, like here's where I really am. And here's my ideal self, which is where I could be, which is closer to my edge. And we try to look at the gap between those two things. Like, here's me actually, here's where I could be potentially. And once we identify that gap, we can start to narrow it. And that's what the six mirrors allow us to do. So the book is kind of structured on, well, here's this mirror. Take a look at yourself as a runner,
yeah.
But then also take a look at yourself in your other life stories, your family, friendships, your career, your education, passions. And your passions. And how can I get closer to my potential? And that's how we use those six mirrors. Like Adam said, it's a reflective process and sometimes a painful reflective process. Yeah. Go, wow, I'm really falling short here and I got to close this gap.
Very interesting. So yeah, so Adam just said that he had a lot of reflection when you guys were writing the book. Did you as well, Tim? Did you guys have any, was it difficult to write about these? And were there any learning moments that you had along the way?
So many learning moments, but I think one of the funniest ones is Adam. When we were writing this chapter, I don't know if you remember this, Adam, we were writing the chapter on like tough and stupid.
Mm-hmm. Adaptability yeah. and lack thereof.
And adaptability. And Adam was like, oh, I would have known this while I was still running.
Yeah, you know, I think that what this allowed us to do is just kind of realize, like, these are the principles that we should be utilizing in our life. And, you know, and so for me with adaptability, you know, and I think this is one every single runner out there deals with. Mm-hmm. And it's we talked about in the book and you know, tough and stupid and the line between tough and stupid. And the goal is, hey, I want to most of the runners out there are stubborn and want to push themselves hard, and something starts to hurt, something starts to bother them, and you know, they're like, ah, well, you know, I can get through this, and they push through until they're broken. And for me, I mean, that was my biggest issue was just the idea that the most important thing is to be tough rather than the most important thing needs to be smart. And realizing and understanding that, hey, I need to back off right now. I need to take a break. It's easier said than done. And I while we're writing this book, I was like, man, if I just would have had the awareness to really and discipline and courage to really say, no, I need to just not run today, or I need to take a couple days and let this heal up. My career, I think, would have gone much longer, and I would have been probably more successful.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, like you said, most runners have a tendency to believe that the more you do, the better you'll be. And so the thought of taking a day off or maybe going on a, you know, an easy run where you should have been doing a workout, we tend to think that we're slacking right. off, whereas we're really benefiting ourselves. So that's a learning moment that I think a lot of runners could probably still afford to come across. But
right. Well, unfortunately, a lot of us have to learn it the hard way.
Yeah.
You know, I think a lot of runners definitely cross that line at least once or twice before they figure it out. And unfortunately for Adam, he crossed it. Well, he just lived on the other side. The running joke when we do like our public speaking appearances and things, like the running joke is I call this the line between Tough and Adam, because he just spent his whole career on the wrong side of that line, and it pays off to a point, but when your body breaks, there's really nothing you can do about it.
Yeah. Yep. Yep. You do have to learn the hard way sometimes. And I think that's true for most runners. So what about you, Tim? Did you have any learning moments as you guys were writing this book?
Too many to talk about, probably. You know, yeah, of course. More so as a human being than even as a runner, because by the time we wrote this book, you know, I'd been out of the world of competitive running for a decade. So I became more of the runner that, you know, doesn't really enter a lot of races. This was before I got into like ultra marathoning and stuff, where I was just kind of running because I liked the way it made me feel, but had no interest in racing. But the other aspects, the learning experiences that I got as a human being were really good. And Adam and I've talked about this a lot, but you know, one of our five life stories we talk about in the book is friendships. And a lot of times looking in the mirror, in all the different mirrors and thinking about friendships, like even my friendship with Adam, I'm like, wow, I could be better. You know, I could make fun of him more. We'd be better friends. But it actually strengthened our relationship just as a friend, you know? And, so I had a lot of learning moments where, and I think it's just good, no matter whether it's like, you know, our philosophy that comes out of this positive psychology realm or something you get out of Buddhism or anything else, like Adam said, awareness is the key. And once you are aware of where your shortcomings are, that then you have the ability to fix them.
Absolutely. Yeah. And it seems like obviously you guys are the best of friends and you have been since college, but you work together as well. How has that dynamic been working together?
Kind of like this.
Yeah. Yeah. You should ask some of the people that work for us.
Ask our team members. They give you a whole range of.
Well, I noticed when I was looking at the website, I noticed your bios and one of them, Adam, you're the official nitpicker and also the attention deficit executive. Well, Tim, I think you're said the head stress bucket. Is that right? So how did you guys earn these titles and how do they reflect your dynamic?
I think they were awarded to us by the people in our group and on our team. You know, I think it's just our personalities and the way we operate, you know, as individuals. I'm pretty detail oriented to the extent where at times it can be cumbersome. You know, sometimes I struggle with is just that it has to be perfect when it's just really, it's already pretty darn good, pretty close to that, you know, and on the flip side, while doing that, you know, I'm easily distracted by the. by the squirrel that's playing around on the tree outside the window, you know? And so, unfortunately,
I saw you guys are both big, big fans of cat videos as well, according to the website. So I'm sure that plays a part in this.
Well, we only hire people who have cats.
Yeah.
Okay.
I was the last one to that party. I just got a cat recently just because I felt so left out.
Yeah.
And with so many cat videos circulating in the office, I caved into the peer pressure, I guess. but yeah, these are not like things that Adam and I actually picked for ourselves. Like
I figured as much.
When one of our girls was making up our bios on the website, she came up with a lot of them, and they've evolved a little bit over time. But yeah, Adam can. You know, there's a chapter in our book about, or there's a story in our book about this is good, but you know, it would make it better.
Yeah.
And that's Adam's moniker on just about everything. So you can take a 5-minute task and spend an hour trying to make it better.
Yep.
Well, I don't think that's so bad. You know, never being fully satisfied with yourself is sometimes that can lead to some good things. So
Definitely.
It makes our company better. And it's a good balance. It's a really good balance because I tend to be a little hasty sometimes because I just want to get stuff done. So Adam balances that part, that aspect of my personality. He balances it out and he's like, no, this isn't exactly perfect yet. So we need to keep working on that. So it balances it out. I tend to stress a lot.
Yeah. I leave the stressing. Well,
I do enough for both of us.
He does enough for both of us. Yeah. So, yeah. Although at the really stressful times when we're both max stressed to the max, then it's not fun for anybody.
Fortunately, that happens like twice a year. We get stressed just when we're launching like a new like virtual challenge.
Yeah.
Just all the logistics that go into that and all the details that go into it. It's like twice a year and we get I get super stressed out and then out everybody else in the office.
Yeah.
And so, OK, so obviously, besides maybe the stress part, you guys do balance each other very well. And I did wonder, did this dynamic exist when you guys were teammates in college? Did you kind of feed off each other the same way you do now?
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
For sure. Yeah, it was instantaneous. Well, I mean, part of it is that I think the reason Adam and I became friends so quickly is because I mean, he came in as a freshman and was already beating everybody on the varsity team. And and I was a senior. And so we became kind of natural training partners. Yeah. Cause it took me 4 years of collegiate development to get to the point he was at coming in as a freshman. So we could spend a lot of time running workouts together and doing our long runs together. And then our personalities just complement each other. And we both from the very beginning would talk about a lot of the stuff that made its way into this book about like how we have to be more than runners. I remember when we were actually taking scuba diving lessons together, it was like this whole thing, like, I've always wanted to scuba dive. Adam's like, me too. Yeah. He's like, let's do it. And I'm like, when? He's like, now. I'm like, okay, fine. And then it's like, well, is this going to interfere with our running? Well, you got to be more than a runner, you know, because that could be a very temporary thing. And so we always had this conversation going on about like, you know, if I step off a curb in the wrong way tomorrow and my running career is over,
then what?
Am I a well enough rounded person that I'm still going to find joy in my life?
Absolutely. Yeah.
That's really a philosophical conversation that literally we were having as college, like as Adam was a freshman, I'm a senior, like what, 21 and 19 years old. So
it's pretty remarkable. You had the self-awareness at that point to know that running isn't everything and you need to have other passions. That's pretty interesting. You guys were already having that discussion at that point.
Yeah.
We like to pretend we're deep.
Yeah. I mean, and quite honestly, we're very, very smart people.
I gathered as much. Yeah.
You know, and
because
so,
we hire really smart people.
Well, that too. No, I mean, whether it's deep or not, I mean, I think it's just kind of like Tim said, we complemented each other with our personalities and challenge each other to be better. Not only at running, but in everything. And that's like, as Tim said, all of those principles, so many of those stories and the talks that we had did make their way into the book. And it's pretty cool. Very
absolutely
cool.
Well, I think something that's interesting you guys have talked on is just this notion of finding success in other passions and other aspects of your life and how that can ultimately come back to finding success in running. Like it's all interconnected and related. And I think a lot of runners do tend to fall into this trap where a lot of their attention revolves around their running solely. And I do think sometimes that that's not healthy. So can you guys talk on that a little bit? How do you feel when runners come to you and you're coaching, how do you advise them to find different passions without sacrificing their running?
Yeah, it's tough. And I think Adam and I both have probably separate experiences we could share on this, but every runner gets to at some point in their career comes to a point where they can't run. And a lot of times that's just for a few moments, right? In the grand scheme of life, where if you have to take 6 months off to heal a stress fracture, or to, you know, because you're going through something in your personal life or whatever. And when it's such a huge part of your life, it definitely can feel like you've been gutted, you know, like this thing's taken away from me. And I know I wrote in the book about how I had to face the hard reality that I wasn't going to be a runner post-collegiately. You know, I was training for the Olympic trials in 96 and I got injured and I was post-collegiate at this point, but I was in graduate school. And so I was still running with the team and I was still running with Mark, our coach. And I was coming back from injury and I was coming back from a long run. And Mark was like, he's like, you know what? He's like, maybe you should just hang him up, which is something you want to hear from your coach. Right.
No.
But he's like, you know, running's taken you as far as it's going to take you. He's like, you're a good national class runner. He's like, but you're not world class and you can keep hammering away at it. But the reality is you're not going to be a world class runner. And he said, so why don't you just go be good at something else? Actually, he said, go be great at something else. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that stung about as bad as anything a coach can ever say to you. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, he was right. And he said in almost exactly these words, he said, if you go apply the same type of passion and determination and work ethic that you've applied to your running at something else, he's like, you can't help but be great at it.
Mm. Wow.
And so I took that with me and I decided to become the best teacher I could possibly be and coach. I coached high school and taught, you know, psychology. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to apply those same principles. Mm-hmm. And so when you talk about having run it, and running wasn't taken away from me as a as an activity. Mm-hmm. It's just running at that level was taken away from me. Mm-hmm. Right. And I had to choose. I had to choose to step aside, which is a hard choice to make. But I think every runner comes to that. Right. And Adam had to retire, which.
Yeah.
For Tim too. I mean, to maybe get a better understanding is like, you know, at the time he was in grad school, but he was investing so much of his daily energy into running,
You know,
trying to get to the next level. There's so much goes into that, where it's like, hey, like you said, the activity of running wasn't taken away. It was just that it was kind of like the reality of, okay, why am I spending the time, this much time on this, when I could still go out for a run and not be as serious about it and move on to other things and be great at other things. And that's the hard part for people is the realization that running isn't everything.
Well, yeah, absolutely.
And we all get to the point, and Adam's past this point now too, although it wasn't at that time, but we all get to a point where all of our PRs are behind us. Like,
yeah,
we're never going to run our fastest race again, like ever.
Right?
I got to that point at like 22. I'm never going to PR at anything that's, you know, under a marathon. Mm-hmm. Cause I hadn't run one yet. I'm never going to PR at anything again. And so you have to find different reasons to keep running.
Yeah. Yep.
And we all do. And which is the beauty of the sport is, you know, Adam's retired, but it doesn't mean he's not running.
Yeah,
absolutely. And it, obviously I know you guys work with a lot of masters runners and a lot of people that kind of are getting into running a little bit later in the game. And so what advice do you give to them when they're trying to find fulfillment in the sport, but, you know, at the same time, they realize that their PRs are probably behind them at this point? What advice can you give to them?
First of all, I mean, I think that most people that find running a little bit later in life, it's not fair to say that your PRs are behind you because so many people are still out there chasing PRs and running and trying to run fast. It's a little different when you're running at a D1 level or US championship world level, and to say, okay, you know, when you start there, as you get older, your PRs are definitely behind you. And even for Tim, you know, cause he was a D1 athlete, as you get older, it's just harder. But when you find running later in life, there's so many things that you can still get after and seek.
Tell me about, so actually Adam set 3 PRs 2 years ago.
What? Really?
Yeah. He set 3 PRs in the space of 4 days. Is that right?
Yeah, well, 6 days. It's all different. So you have to put it in perspective, right? I'm not going to run. I'll never be as fast as I once was. But it doesn't mean I can't challenge myself to do different, new and different things. And I kind of got talked into doing this crazy race with Tim. And it was a 6 day stage race. Ooh. Yeah. 120 miles over 6 days through the Rocky Mountains. So I mean, you know, you look at how I trained when I was younger, and honestly not trained very much since I retired. Going into this, it was pretty interesting because I did hit some pretty big milestones. I hit 2 of the longest runs of my life during that 6 days.
Wow.
And up to that point, 22 miles was my longest, and we had a 24 mile day
and a 25 mile day.
Yeah. Wow. And so I hit 2 of those days during that. And then also my highest mileage week ever, which was 120 miles in
6 days.
In 6 days, not 7 days.
Oh my gosh. Wow.
Yeah,
I'm sure that was satisfying. Fun, right? Yeah. That had to be satisfying to know that was the longest you'd ever gone in your entire running career.
Yeah. Once I recovered, it was satisfying. once I got over calling myself an idiot for doing that, you know, I
grew back 9 toenails.
Yeah, 9 of my 10 toenails that were gone. Yeah. Oh, no. I think that, yeah, it is. You have to set goals and challenge yourself in different ways. And that's what it's about. Realizing for runners that there are other things in life, especially when you're running at such an elite level, or you're trying to, when you just put all of your focus in that and all of your focus into just that, it's that's kind of what we talk about in the books. Like, you need to do that. You need to put in a lot of focus. You need to really be true to what you're trying to do, but realize that if running ended on that on any given day, that you would still be a functioning human being.
Yeah. Life doesn't end as we know it.
That's the key, is like, realize that there's other things that you can be doing and that are just as satisfying. And
yeah. And when you get to a later stage in your career, you find other challenges.
Yeah.
That's still within running, and you still can have goals, and then you can still work towards those goals.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like that. So I feel like this kind of falls into line with this term in your book that you guys came up with that was called the distance maven. So you tell us what that means and how you came by that term.
Yeah, for sure. We stole the term.
stole it.
It's a term that's been around, but we came across it from Malcolm Gladwell.
Okay.
So I had just read his book, Tipping Point, and he introduces the idea of the maven. And it's not like we don't credit Malcolm Gladwell in the book, because we do. We'd say... we found this term from Malcolm Gladwell, the maven. And as he describes the maven, it's somebody who's really passionate about something. And he talks about how people can be car mavens, where they're just really, really into cars. He talks about soap mavens. There are people out there just really, really into soap.
Yeah.
And they exist, right? And a couple of their attributes are that they are super passionate, super knowledgeable, and want to share that passion and knowledge with other people. And so we kind of partnered that idea of the maven with distance running. And so basically, in a nutshell, a distance maven is somebody who's super passionate about running, super knowledgeable about running, and wants to share that passion and share that knowledge with as many other people as possible. That's literally where we came up with the term distance maven. And somebody who really wants to push themselves to reach their edge, to reach their maximum potential as runners, but also as human beings.
After the break, Tim and Adam will share a little more about what they do at Run the Edge and tell us about their latest marathon virtual challenge. Don't forget, if you are interested in joining the marathon challenge, stay tuned till the end to get your discount. This is Sinead Hockey, and you're listening to Run to the Top at Runners Connect. While we runners usually practice good, nutrient-dense diets, most of us lack the amino acids needed to break down and process the proteins we consume. This is bad news for both recovery and muscle growth, not to mention a ton of other vital life processes. That's why Body Health created Perfect Amino, the perfect blend of the 8 essential amino acids to help you build your muscles, expedite recovery, and nab that next personal record. I take Perfect Amino tablets every day and mix the Perfect Amino XP powder in my post-workout smoothies for extended protein absorption. This has helped me work harder and reach new levels in my running, something so important to the Body Health team that if you place in your age group at any public racing event, they'll put you in their winner's circle and send you a free bottle of Perfect Amino. Check it out at runnersconnect.net/winner-circle to learn more, and don't forget to use coupon code RUNNERSCONNECT on your next purchase. That's Runners Connect in all caps. Make sure to also visit runnersconnect.net/bodyhealth, where you can enter to win a 6-pack of Perfect Amino worth $230. Again, that's runnersconnect.net/bodyhealth. I wish you the best of luck. When I started using gels to fuel during my long runs and workouts, I'll be honest, I couldn't find one that I didn't hate having to take. All the gels I tried were either too sweet or too thick, making them hard to consume without chasing them down with gulps and gulps of water. They also seemed to be giving me all sorts of GI issues, which obviously made long runs and workouts a lot harder than they needed to be, but even more importantly, I felt like they were impacting my overall health. That is until I discovered Excel Gel by Pacific Health Labs. Unlike most gels, Excel Gel has a thin consistency that makes it easy to take while running, and it's also all natural, completely free of gluten and preservatives you just don't need. It's also the only gel on the market that has the proven 4-to-1 ratio of carbs to protein, as well as a mix of carbohydrates to smooth glucose uptake and extend endurance. Excel Gel helps me get the most out of my long runs and workouts, and I absolutely love it, especially the raspberry cream flavor with caffeine. Right now, Pacific Health is offering all Run to the Top listeners free samples of Excel Gel. All you have to do is send an email to info@pacifichealthlabs.com with the subject line Run to the Top. Then simply request your Excel Gel samples, as well as the address you'd like them mailed to, and then you can try them for yourself for free. Again, that's info@pacifichealthlabs.com. If you want to check out more of Pacific Health's great products, you can do so at runnersconnect.net/Pacific Health. We are back with Tim and Adam, and earlier you guys were talking about how the most stressful time of the year for you is when you are relaunching your virtual challenges. And I know you're currently in the midst of all that, so I do appreciate you coming on the show while you're doing that. But the one that you are relaunching is your A Marathon Challenge. So can you tell us a little bit about that and what it entails?
Sure. I'll start.
So, yeah, we are about to relaunch. Last year, we started what we call the A Marathon Challenge.
It's spelled like America with thon at the end.
Yeah, A-N-D-R-I-T-H-O-N.
I like it. Yep.
And really what it was it's just creating a challenge for people to get out and run a marathon. In a marathon, you can run, bike, swim, whatever. You can just, as long as you're out there doing miles. And it's a challenge that starts virtually at the Golden Gate Bridge and takes you all the way across the country and finishes at the Washington Monument. And it's a lot of fun. We had a great time. Probably we had so much fun creating it and putting it together.
But, oh my gosh, that was like one of the best 6 month stretches of our company.
It was a lot of fun
together. And like Adam said, it's a virtual. So you're accumulating miles, mm-hmm. and then those miles virtually have you travel across the country.
Yeah,
I love that. That's such a great idea.
Through beautiful countryside, we made flyover videos where people can actually see every step of the journey across the United States. You get to learn a little bit about geography, mm-hmm. particularly with Adam's videos. He points out all the flyovers and he's like, hey, over here is where peanut butter was invented.
Oh, I like that. Get some trivia.
Yeah, just little things. We have fun with it. And we had a blast doing it. And so we launched it last July and we're just kind of revamping it. And right now, I mean, we're in the process of when we do launch this month, we have a new mileage tracker. So we have a essentially where people can go and they can sync up their Garmins or Fitbits, manually input their miles, whatever it is. And you're earning those miles as you go and your milestones or what we call landmark badges along the way.
Yeah, like when you hit the Grand Canyon.
Yeah.
You get a badge.
Ooh, very cool.
So it's just little things to break it up and make it a lot more fun. And
And one of the things that's cool about it, and goes back to what you were just asking us about with the camaraderie, is in this particular challenge, you can take it with up to 8 people.
Oh, so okay. Very cool.
Instead of one person having to do all 3,500 miles of this journey, up to eight people, can take it as a team. And so like if the three of us were on a team and say, you know, I ride my bike for 10 miles, Adam goes on a 2 mile run and you go on and you run a marathon, it combines all those miles together and makes our team, you know, go a lot more quickly through the landmarks and the badges. Yeah.
Very cool. I love that. Yeah. So it's, you can accumulate mileage with friends.
And you earn this medal that weighs over a pound by the time because you earn the pieces as you go across the country and they magnetically snap into a kind of like a United States.
Yeah.
And, I saw that. That's a really cool medal. It's like a puzzle piece almost.
It kind of goes together like a puzzle. Colt loves to play with it.
Yeah.
it's a really, really fun challenge. It's got a passport and stickers. We could go on for days about it.
That's so cool.
We put in so many details. And the idea is that it's not like just a virtual 5K that lasts one day. Like we're into making fitness a habit for people.
Mm.
And because we allow in this particular challenge, swimming, biking, mm-hmm. walking, hiking, any way you want to get out there and do human powered, you know, miles, you're making fitness a habit, and it's going to take, you know, if you do it as an individual, it's going to take you, you know, probably more than a year to finish it. But we want to keep people motivated to get out consistently and get in miles and just focus on that, that idea that this is a part of my lifestyle. This is something like brushing my teeth. Every day I brush my teeth and I go out and I walk, I run, I bike, whatever.
That's fantastic. Yeah. It's just kind of like making it into a learned habit every day. I really like that. So is there a time frame people have to complete the challenge in, or is it just kind of, can they go at their own pace? How does that work?
No, there's no, for the marathon challenge, there's no timeline. You know, if it takes you 2 years, it takes you 2 years.
We have teams that finish it in 3 months.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay.
You get some teams that are putting in
heavy bikers,
a lot of miles, to get done quick. So really, we just want to, no timeline on it. And I was, one thing to say is not only making it a habit for these people, but also making it fun.
Making
it fun, making it interactive and creative, and just so it's not monotonous, and you know, and to have that community of supporters, because it is a one big community of like-minded individuals that are supporting one another, and it's pretty special.
It's so rewarding, because we always tell people to embrace two goals with both of our big virtual challenges. Your number one goal should be to finish the challenge. And your number two goal should be to help other people finish their challenge.
Oh, I like that. Yeah.
And that it makes for a special community where people are literally celebrating accomplishments of their peers who they've never met.
Right.
Virtual, right? They live in a virtual online community, and they support each other. And it's, I mean, there's things that go on inside of our communities that'll give you chills. You know, when people are bearing their soul and saying, you know, I never thought I could do it, but today, you know, I ran a mile without stopping.
Absolutely. I think the community aspect is so important. I mean, we at Runners Connect, that's pretty much what we're structured around, is our community. And I think, you know, for runners, it's important to feel like you're a part of something bigger than yourself. And you guys are clearly achieving that with this a marathon challenge.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So can people start at any point? I know you're relaunching it this month, but can people join in whenever they want?
Yep. You can start for a marathon challenge. You can literally start anytime, although our new tracker is scheduled to open mid-July. And that's a really good starting point. Last year, we started it on July 4th, mm-hmm. which that's kind of a mistake. It's a holiday.
Yeah.
You know, but anyway, but so we're going mid-July this time, but people can literally start. We have people register every single day for it. And like Adam said, they can just take their time and take their time and hurry across the country.
That's fantastic. I love that. So do you guys, are most of your clients, are they mostly in America, or do you guys have people overseas even joining this challenge?
Yeah. I mean, we have participants between both of our challenges in 57, 58 different countries around the world.
Oh, okay. Wow.
And, you know, which is pretty darn cool. I mean, so
yeah, we love shipping packages to, you know, we're like, hey, this one's going to Malaysia.
Yeah.
That's so cool.
This package here is going to Belgium. You know, this package is going to Mongolia. It's pretty cool when you see where stuff goes. But most, for a marathon in particular,
majority,
you know, it's like 90%
American. Naturally. But it's cool that you bring runners from all over the world together. That's pretty special. So
yeah.
One more thing I wanted to ask you guys. Obviously, you're relaunching your marathon challenge this month, but what else do you guys have on tap for Run the Edge? What's in the future for you guys?
Ooh.
Oh, well, you know what? I don't think we can. Should we tell them?
Man.
I mean,
it's a top secret.
Yeah, the thing is, you know, we don't want to. There's so many things going on in the world that, you know, if we revealed all of our secrets, you know, it would take away from the really important things. It's all people would be talking about is what we're going to be doing next.
I understand. I understand completely.
The important agendas. There's so much going on. Now, we have, like, seriously, for the rest of 2017 and move into 2018, we do have some really, really cool new things that'll be coming online.
Awesome. Okay.
Not quite ready to tell you what they are yet.
Well, that's just fine. We'll link your website below our interview, and people can keep track of you guys, see what's new with Run the Edge, and see what you guys are up to. I'm a little bit curious myself, but We'll link that below.
It does work, huh?
That's cool.
Golden tree.
It does.
Now we're going to have to come up with something.
I know. Dang it. Why'd you have to open your mouth?
I don't know.
Big mouth.
I know. Can't help.
Yep. You guys are under pressure now. You're going to have to, show up. Well, yep. Thank you guys so much. This has been such a great interview. And I think a lot of people are going to be signing up for that Amarathon challenge this month. Hopefully a lot of our users will as well. So really appreciate you guys taking the time to sit down with us today. And thank you so much for this interview. Really appreciated it.
I haven't talked about this, so we're going to negotiate on your podcast.
Oh,
okay.
Do you want to offer their listeners something?
Sure. What do you want to do?
I don't know, like a promo code.
That would be great. If you guys don't mind, that would be awesome.
I tell you what, without knowing exactly what it is, if you go to sign up for a marathon and you type in the promo code Runners Connect, you'll get $5 off your registration.
Ooh, I like that. Okay. I think our listeners are going to be pretty excited. You heard him. If you are interested in joining Adam and Tim's Amarathon Challenge, you can do so through the link below. Don't forget to type in promo code RUNNERSCONNECT with no space for $5 off your purchase, no matter which package you choose. And check out the links below also to follow Adam and Tim and see what else Run the Edge has to offer. I think it's safe to say these two hit the friend jackpot when they met each other. Like they said, they have seen each other at their lowest of lows and highest of highs. And this is obviously one of the reasons we make so many lifelong connections through running. Tim and Adam's passion for the sport is truly contagious. And I hope this interview has inspired you to continually run the edge, or in other words, just expect the best of yourself. So next week, we have another pretty exciting guest on the show, and I think you might be familiar with him. He's a two-time Olympian in the 800, and he's also the CEO of Run Gum, a fast-growing company that creates caffeinated gum designed for those of us who want a little bit of a boost on the go. His name is Nick Simmons, and I can't wait to have him on the show. As you may know, Nick recently retired from the track, and he's now turning his sights to the marathon, which, you know, is a little different than the two laps around the track he's used to. Nick will be running the Honolulu Marathon this December, and he's inviting along one lucky winner to join him for an all-inclusive trip to Hawaii. Check out the link below if you're interested in entering the contest, and stay tuned for next week's interview with Nick. I wish you the best of luck. One more thing before I wrap up this episode. If you enjoyed today's podcast, we would love for you to either subscribe or leave a review at iTunes or wherever you get your podcasts. This really helps us reach more runners like yourself and provide them information from experts in the sport that will help them run faster and stay healthy. Thank you so much to all of those who already have done so. And thank you so much for joining me today. I really hope you have enjoyed this podcast and that you tune in again next week. Until then, have a great run today.
Thanks for listening to the Run to the Top podcast from runnersconnect.net.